is when I left Cisco and started packet design, I was concerned then that the Valley was getting shorter and shorter term focused, and a lot of the innovation that was going on was really very incremental and not disruptive innovation. And although people think of the bubble as lots of innovation, actually it was innovation around business models. And from a science and technology perspective, there I felt that our horizons were actually closing in and there was not as much innovation going on. In 2005, I actually started to give more presentations about innovation, still very concerned about the state of the Valley, how people had just become significantly more risk-averse and shorter-term focused, as well as I sit on the boards of FedEx and Disney, two great corporations. And I was also seeing the same thing happen between Wall Street and public companies, that there's this pressure for a focus on short-term earnings. So the book actually started from a concern about Silicon Valley and the business world. But as I started the journey of interviewing people and writing the book, I actually broadened my perspective and started to look not just at the Valley, because when you're running companies, you're really very heads down focused, but started looking at the broader issues of research in this country, in academia, as well as policy and education, and how those issues were impacting innovation, and began to realize that they were all very tied together. And so the book started out a little more business focused, but in the end ended up what I call a business plus book. So there's a message here for businesses about how to create environments in which innovation can thrive, and what are some of the mistakes that leaders make that actually stifle innovation. But I went beyond that, and actually there's a message or a challenge to the nation that I believe that we are now at a point where something that has been a core strength of American society, which is an innovative spirit, is really at risk. More the framework, because the fact of the matter is, depending on who you're talking to, whether you're talking to a corporate leader, an entrepreneur, a venture capitalist, a scientist in academia, a policymaker in government, everybody thinks innovation is something different. Yet we use it as this soundbite. So I actually think there are three main types of innovation. People historically have talked about disruptive innovation or breakthrough innovation, as well as incremental innovation. And that's how, if you look at most books, that's how people categorize them. I actually think there's a third type of innovation, and I call it orthogonal innovation. And that is taking existing technology, but applying it, the reason I call it orthogonal, applying it in a different way, thinking about a problem in a different way. And one of the best examples of orthogonal innovation is actually the iPod. Because all of the technology for the iPod existed, but the phenomenal success comes from the fact that Apple did not build an MP3 player. They built a complete system of delivering music in a new way. And that wasn't a breakthrough in technology, but it was a different way of thinking about the problem. What has had its heyday was the days in which technologies for technology's sake wasn't. If you really want to think about innovation, you have to think about the complete ecosystem that innovation exists. And that's why it's really important when you think about innovation to think about having balance across the ecosystem and look at whether you're a company or a country, you want to have an innovation portfolio that is balanced across the different community. Look at a biological ecosystem. The definition is communities of organisms that interact with their environment. And with a natural ecosystem, if it's not in balance, it can't sustain life. The same thing, so if you take sunlight away from an ecosystem, you're not going to have things grow. So in the innovation ecosystem, you have the same notion where you have these communities that we just talked about, but the environmental factors, as opposed to being sunlight and water, are leadership, and that's probably the most important, funding, policy, education, and culture. Mm-hmm. And these are true for companies as well as the country. And I think that over the last several decades, we have had a problem with leadership, with inspiration, with vision. Funders, whether it's venture capitalists and private companies or Wall Street and public companies, are putting so much pressure on leaders to look at their short-term results over the long term that companies are being led for the short term. And that if you do that, you get incremental innovation. When the venture entrepreneurial ecosystem was healthy, mm-hmm. when you have lots of startups that are getting funded, mm-hmm. that are taking risks and coming up with disruptive technologies, then you can have large companies partner with those small companies and buy them in. So mm-hmm. Precept, the company that I started that Cisco acquired, had done some disruptive innovation in video streaming a long time ago before it became what it is today. But if it was today, Precept wouldn't get funded because the venture capitalists in general have become much more risk averse. And when you go to raise money, they want to know, they want customer validation. And what we really need to do is take a step back and say, how do we address this? How do we go back to a time when entrepreneurs were willing to take more risk and venture capitalists were willing to take more risk and got rewarded. And I think one of the reasons why we've gotten fooled in some ways into believing that things are better off than there are is that there's actually lots of innovation going on in the consumer internet web 2.0 type of space. I think this notion of you can get started very quickly, it's good, but it also adds to the problem because people get started, but then they can't necessarily get the capital to grow. There are five really key things that need to exist and they need to be in balance. So let me just explain them. One is questioning. And by questioning, I mean curiosity, but I also mean self-assessment. The ability to look at what you're doing and question the status quo and say, should I be doing this in a different way? If you look at the best entrepreneurs, they're constantly self-assessing. And if you look at one of the biggest problems that this country has had in its national policy and national leadership is not self-assessing. We've done very little self-assessment and being willing to say, well, maybe that was wrong. The second is risk. And what does risk mean? It means a willingness to fail. If you're not willing to say, I might fail and I'm going to learn from that failure, you don't take risks. And when I'm talking about risk, I'm not talking about gambling. I'm not talking about subprime mortgages and that type of risk. I'm talking about the willingness for a company or a person or a venture capitalist to say, I'm going to try something, and you know what, it might not work. But if it doesn't work, I won't get shot down for it. I will learn from that, and I will tell you that I think that the attitude towards failure in the Valley has shifted a little. And it used to be that if you had tried to start a company and it had failed, you would be looked upon by the VCs more favorably than someone who had never tried. Today, that's not necessarily true. Today, someone who was a low-level employee at Google but had been affiliated with success will actually be given more points than someone who had started a company and failed. One of the biggest problems big companies have is this notion of people being afraid to fail. Because if I fail, I won't get promoted. I won't go on to the next step. And if you create an environment where people are afraid to fail, they won't try. People underestimate the importance in creating environments where people trust that they can be vulnerable. If you can't just talk about failure being okay, you have to show it. And the whole idea of Six Sigma is to make your processes very predictable, take all the surprises out, all the defects out. And they talk about having black belts and brown belts that go about training people in the company in Six Sigma. So I actually think Six Sigma is fine for manufacturing, but it's terrible for disruptive innovation or even little innovation, because it takes all the room out of the system for surprises. So I actually came up in the book, I talk about we need leaders who don't have black belts but have green thumbs. Because leading for innovation is more like nurturing than it is like karate. It isn't, it's more instinctive. It's more ambiguous. You have to be willing to not necessarily know exactly what the outcome is. If you think about a gardening analogy and nurturing plants, you have to have the right soil, the right environment, the right environmental factors. But one very interesting part of this is once you have a little seedling, you often need to transplant it. And so one of the challenges, whether you're acquiring, a big company is acquiring a small company, or whether you're outsourcing innovation, or you go to a university and you want to take some, license some ideas, the biggest challenge is how do you transplant a little seedling, an idea and a passion into a new environment without it dying. And in gardening, that transplanting step is a very delicate step. And the same is true with innovation. And the reason being is that so much of innovation is about the people who have the passion and the vision to drive it. And if you don't transplant those people and that passion with the idea, if the idea is too new, it'll end up dying. The problem with the innovation deficit is that we're reaping the benefits of what we planted, but we're not planting for the future. And the tricky thing about this is that we won't see it until it's too late. We think there's lots of innovation going on. We have iPhones and iPods and all these wonderful new websites that are great, but we are not planting the seeds that we need for 10, 20, and 30 years from now. We think there's lots of innovation going on. We have iPhones and iPods and all these wonderful new websites that are great, but we are not planting the seeds that we need for 10, 20, and 30 years from now. And, you know, when I was at Stanford, sitting in a lab, sending packets back and forth on the initial TCP research, we didn't know that this was the beginning, this would ultimately become the World Wide Web. We knew it was exciting, we knew it was important, but not, we had no idea where it would go. And we're not funding enough of that kind of work that may look like it is not directly applicable, but will become foundational. I think that innovation is not a vertical. I think innovation goes so across everything. And so I think that whoever is the next president needs to be the chief innovation officer. When something's really complicated, you can either say, forget it, this is a mess, or I actually tell the story in the book that I'll never forget my first programming class, and these were in the days of mainframes. And so you didn't get to sit at a terminal, you had to submit your programming.
On punch cards.
And my father was a computer science professor of computer science. So I went to UCLA, I was living at home, and I would be up all night, and I would keep submitting my job, and it would come back, and it would say ab-end, which is abnormal ending. And I just remember one day coming home just in tears because I was just overwhelmed by how was I going to solve this problem. And my dad looked at me and he said, Judy, the trick to an overwhelming problem is to figure out how to break the problem into pieces that still all fit together, but pieces that individually can be solved. And then go solve those pieces, but keep in mind how they all fit in the big puzzle. And I would argue that to me was one of the best lessons I ever had in problem solving. What we need is people who can take the big picture and say, okay, here's the big picture, now what are some pieces that we can inspire people to go work on, and let's go find the smartest people in the country and get them working on it. some people I would interview would, a few people I interviewed said, you know, Judy, just forget it. America is in decline. Great societies fail. We've had it. It's over. Don't even try. A few people said that. A number of people said to me, Judy, I don't know what you're so alarmed about. Markets go in cycles. We're just in a cycle. Let the market take care of it, and the market will solve the problems. And markets tend to work problems out. And what I realized is I didn't believe either one of those were true. And I'm not a big believer in the government controlling everything, but I came to the conclusion that the markets could, the problems we have in front of us, our markets, our capital markets have become so short-term focused that we can't rely on. My conclusion is we really need business leaders, political leaders, educational leaders, as well as individuals who are leaders as parents, leaders in their communities, to really take this stuff seriously and work together to come up with the right compromises for long-term solutions, and then figure out what are the band-aids we need to put on right away to stop the bleeding. And we need to do both of those. And these are hard problems, but we really have gotten ourselves into a mess. And I believe we can solve it with the right leadership. You know, I don't know what comes next. If you go back to those core values, one of them is openness, one of them is questioning. I know that for me, writing this book was an incredible learning experience. It really allowed me to kind of take my head out of the valley and look at the country and look at the world in a different perspective. This was hard. It was hard. That's what happens. You know, it's like after you have a child, you say that. But I have a lot of respect for those of you who write for a living. So it.